Okay. I think you can all hear me. I think I'm mic'd up. So good evening or good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. We're all very excited to be here. This panel is really important because big data is really important, okay? Big data and analytics are becoming increasingly common, and that's because data is becoming increasingly common. More and more consumers are sharing their information online. You see this increase in public disclosure. Also, it's becoming easier for companies to share, collect, and store information. So we're seeing this huge drive in these innovations, which is leading to increases in online advertising, better machine learning techniques, better financial models. So it's a very, very exciting time to be in data science. What comes with that, though, are some ethical dilemmas. One of the most famous dilemma that we may or may not talk about later is in 2012, a man found out that his teenage daughter was pregnant because she received a targeted mailer from Target. In response to that, of course, Target decided to obfuscate their mailers, and now they include generic advertisements as well as those targeted advertisements for moms-to-be. So what are the responsibilities of companies towards balancing this need for data, this need for innovation, with their responsibilities towards their consumers? So to that end, we are very pleased to have two distinguished panelists, Morgan Reed and Alessandro Acquisti. Morgan Reed is the executive director of ACT, the App Association. He's a widely respected expert in government impact on technology innovation, specializing in app industry issues. He is an expert coder as well as business owner, and he has led ACT, the App Association's growth in app companies, representing more than 5,000 app makers, and he has been, he has testified in front of the US Senate and House in multiple hearings and been interviewed by the Wall Street Journal, Washington Post, Fox Business News, Reuters, NPR, Fast Company, and Recode. So thank you and welcome.
No problem. Thank you. So do I have a clicker?
Get that work.
This one? All right. So first things first, show of hands, how many people here have a smartphone? Thank you, you pay my salary. So on behalf of my organization, I say thank you. We are a trade association that represents the vast majority of the applications companies that builds the apps that you love, that you stare at when you're supposed to be paying attention to your teacher. We also are fortunate that we get to work with the platform companies, the Apples, the Microsofts of the world as well. But what's very interesting about this position is the way that this device that sits in your pocket, well, another good question. Show of hands, how many people think, what's the average distance that your phone is away from an American? 10 feet? Show of hands, you think it's 10 feet or more? 5 feet or more? 3 feet or less? Good, okay, you know your data science. So the average American is never more than 3 feet away from their smartphone, including bathroom and in bed. And that device is loaded with sensors. Speed sensors, distance sensors, how much you shake it, whether or not it's exposed to water, light, enormous amount. And then this device that I'm wearing on my wrist, it's a watch, but not really. It's a platform for sensors. So with this huge amount of data that is pouring into the app that's on your device, and then concomitantly flowing to analytics providers, data companies, other advertisers, et cetera, there's a lot of questions that we get into on how do you use that. So Dr. Rhue presented this as our topic, and it's quite a mouthful. Ethical dilemmas and implications in the business uses of data, including but not limited to the landscape of consumer data, collection, consumer privacy, and company policies for handling data. Whew. Really? That's the part that matters. Business uses. Because business uses determines almost the rest of that entire sentence. And I'm going to give you three examples. And they're the ones that I like to use. Again, another show of hands. Are these three companies all technology companies? Yes or no? Yeah? I would argue no. I would say they all use technology, but they are not technology companies. Apple is a hardware company. It makes its money from the sale of physical things that you purchase. Microsoft is a software company. They sell seat licenses and now cloud computing, storage, application power, et cetera. 94% of Google's revenue comes from advertising. not the sale of technology. Apple sells a technological device. Microsoft sells a technologically created thing. That's where their money comes from, back to our slide. The business use, the thing they produce, the technology they sell, is actually where they get their money from. And in the case of two of those companies, it's from the sale of the actual technology. Now, that does not mean that Google isn't intrinsically a huge part of our global technology infrastructure, but their business use differs in the way they approach data. And that affects three key things that we've seen recently. Now, Forbes had created this line, Google users, you're the product, not the customer. We all know that one. It's pretty well known, but it influences and affects the way that Google looks at the data it collects from you. And by the way, unless you are running a company, you are not Google's customer, you are a user. They're very careful in the terms of service and all the statements they make to refer to you as a user of their product. Now, the fact that they monetize your data for targeted behavioral advertising is completely appropriate, and there's nothing wrong with it, and it drives a huge portion of the internet. But back to that business uses point, it differs in the way they see you. When you buy an iPhone, you're Apple's customer. When you buy a seat license on Microsoft, you are their customer. Now, Microsoft's a funny beast because it's kind of straddling two canoes, and it affects the way they look at data. So what was interesting is, I don't know if you guys are familiar with this, but Microsoft actually is fighting a court case against the United States DOJ to protect the data of what we are told is an Irish drug dealer. Why would Microsoft be doing that? Well, because remember, their primary thing that they sell is seat licenses on software and now cloud computing technology, which they do an amazing job at. They are dominating a lot of the business space when it comes to cloud computing capabilities. But they ran into a problem. If they build a data center and store data on an Irish citizen in Ireland, does the United States government automatically get access to that because Microsoft is a US domiciled company? Well, the DOJ said yes. Microsoft went to court to say no. And back to the uses of the data, from their perspective, they weren't going to hand over that data because they sell that security, that trust, that framework, that environment, which is critical to the businesses that they sell to. And so they went to court and they won. Actually, in a surprise to everyone, including us who filed an amicus brief, Microsoft was the winner in the Second Circuit. We are likely to see legislation that will come out that will define the scope of what we can do in this space. But Microsoft was willing to put their company's reputation on the line to defend what ostensibly probably isn't a very nice guy because of the way that they use data and the way they're, more importantly, their customers use data. It was critical to protect that. Apple's just started something very interesting. Apple wants to be in the big data business, but they aren't in the business of advertising. They don't, like Microsoft, they don't have a search engine, unlike Microsoft. They don't have, you know, there's no Bing. There's none of that advertising environment. So Apple has taken the approach that they are going to do differential privacy. If I wanted to figure out, and I'll give you a quick example of differential privacy, if I wanted to figure out the average number of people in this room whose ages are even and odd, I could go around and ask everybody's age, and then I could take that number in, and then I could derive and figure out if, okay, is a class slightly more odd or even? Well, the problem with that is that I have to take personal information from you, your date of birth. And that's generally considered to be, if not sensitive, it certainly is personal information, especially attached to a unique identifier or any other context. Now, what happens if I look at Susan and I say, okay, Susan, what's your age? And before she gives me that number, I add what's called noise. And in that noise, I'm going to change her number instead of her actual date, birth, year of 29, and I'm going to make it 6,432 to the 32nd power. And for you, it's going to be 42, and for you, it's going to be 837, and I'm going to add noise. But mathematically, I'm going to build in a bias on the front end of that noise, so when I collect the information for the entire room, I can actually derive almost down to the person what the average is for the entire room. And that's critical because it allows me to collect information that I need to get the results for big data without actually having to collect personal information. But back to her question, is that more ethical? I don't know, but it does serve their business use Because remember, they aren't in the business of monetizing your information for advertising or any other purpose. So for them, differential privacy is what they would consider to be an ethical outcome because it meets their business goals, which is to build an environment of really high quality, very expensive, and very, quote, trustworthy products that they want consumers to feel comfortable with. And so they are spending energy and engineering resources and time to essentially strip identifying information, but yet still have the power of big data behind them. And you don't have to watch me on time. And there's thousands of companies that are now occupying this space. A couple that you probably don't realize are big players. You know about IBM, but Amazon, huge in this space. Also major analytics providers. Although Google is the number one provider of web analytics in one regard, about 92%, in fact, most of the Fortune 500 companies have their web analytics done by Adobe. Adobe bought another company that is the main backbone for a huge chunk of web and now mobile analytics, and it's separate and apart from, you know, your brother's website where he's putting up funny videos. So very quickly to understand, a lot of this is driven by what business you're in, and all of these people are all looking around, and they all have different outcomes, and they use different technologies to get it. But very quickly, let's do a drive down on what it looks like and what it means into a more sensitive area. As I said, business model dictates data behavior. So let's look at health. Healthcare in the United States is a $3 trillion industry. About $900 billion of that flows through CMS, but also the IoT marketplace in health and wellness is expected to be about $117 billion. Huge. In fact, something most people don't realize is that by 2050, roughly a third of the American population will be over the age of 65. One of the key characteristics of old people is they spend a lot of money on healthcare. On average, your last 2 years of life, you do 33% of your lifetime healthcare spend. So that number of $117 billion is only on an upward trajectory, only. Because we will have too many old people, we will not have a place to put them. I will be one of them. So this is something that we're all dealing with. And we know that wearables improve fitness, we've got all those. But you know what? Back to our business model and ethics, part of providing that is providing transparency. How do I provide transparency on the Netatmo that has no screen? Or a Medtronic continuous glucose monitor that has no screen? So how am I providing that information is something we now have to consider. And then where do we wear it? Well, this is an ugly thing designed by a bunch of professor types, but it's very interesting from all the sensors it has on it. And so you'd say, well, that's not gonna happen, except here you go, Hexaskin, $399. And that, Under Armour. By 2030, maybe 2035, I expect about 80% of all of Under Armour's clothes to be wired in. 80%. When you sit down with their CEO, that should tell you right there where they're looking at the future. And how, on that, do I provide some kind of total notice? How do I provide information? How do I make you aware of what I'm doing with that data? What analytics companies I'm sharing with? There are portions of that suit which I don't want ever going to any analytics company. So how do I inform the consumer? And what can it do? Well, we're already seeing watches that can help people with epilepsy. This is a convulsion sensor that's built into a watch. This one's going through FDA process. I think it has not been approved yet, but you can see that it's much of the same sensors that are on here. That's the latest in continuous glucose monitoring. That's all the rage, and you'll see that everywhere. Type 2 diabetes is a unbelievably huge problem in the United States. And what will the data do? Well, obviously exercise smarter, controlling host applications. You've got a laundry list of what big data can do in this healthcare context. But what are we waiting for? Well, we said transparency, but also malpractice. You know, it's one thing to leave something in there, but what if my diagnostics that I'm building into that suit do something with your data that's untoward? How do I deal with that? How do I punish the bad guy? How do I even know where that data came from? And then, of course, reimbursement, which is still a big problem. And then that we still only have about 21% penetration. So the big data we have is still not off that many people. Should you panic now? No. The good news is most of you are going to enter into a business world where big data is going to, in so many ways, change the decisions you make as a business leader. You will be looking to big data to guide your output. But the question is that you have to decide is when you collect that data, how have you informed those people that you collected the data from? And more importantly, and always remember, that is your big data collection driven by your business use? And if it's not, then you ought not to collect it. And if it is, then you need to tell people why. And with that, I'll turn it over to Alessandro.
So our second panelist is Alessandro Acquisti, professor of information technology and public policy at Heinz College at Carnegie Mellon University, and the director of Privacy Economics and Experiments Lab at CMU. His studies examine privacy disclosure on online networks, the application of behavioral economics to study privacy and information security. He has received numerous awards, including the PET Award for Outstanding Research in Privacy-Enhancing Technologies and the IBM Best Academic Privacy Faculty Award. His research has been supported by the NSF, the Department of Homeland Security, NSA, Microsoft, and Google. He has testified before the U.S. Senate House Committees, and his work has been featured in The Economist, The New York Times, Wall Street Journal, NPR, CNN, and 60 Minutes. His 2009 study on the predictability of Social Security numbers was featured in The Year in Ideas and influenced the U.S. Social Security Administration to change the Social Security number assignment scheme in 2011. So with that, we welcome Alessandro Acquisti.
Thank you. Thank you, Lauren. Thank you for the invitation. It's a pleasure to share with you some of the research we've been doing related to privacy. I'm an economist by training. Much of what I do is about the economic consequences of protecting and sharing data. But I also move into behavior economics and behavior decision research applied to privacy, how people make decisions about privacy. And this led me to get interested in social media, Facebook, Twitter, and to start collaborating with data miners and people who do analytics at Carnegie Mellon University to try to understand the technical consequences of sharing data. So the study Lauren was just mentioning about social security numbers is not the typical study that an economist would do, is about data mining, but really my research tries to combine these different areas. Much of what I will talk about today is about the first stream of work, the economics of privacy, and is related to a review of the field that we published a few months ago in the journal Economic Literature. Before I start talking about the study, I will use, as a framing device, three statements that I found either in academic articles or in interviews published in journals, non-academic journals or newspapers, about that capture what I believe is the conventional wisdom about the economic impact of privacy. One first comment and first frame. Concern about privacy are ubiquitous, but to real economists, they seem very puzzling because there is really no market failure we can see. So in other words, if you care about privacy, maybe you care for psychological reasons, but there are no real good economic reasons for caring for privacy. I'm a little simplifying and pushing the envelope here. Second frame, second comment, second citation. Privacy regulation imposed on the internet is actually would limit information flows. It would create market failures where actually right now they do not exist. So trying to protect through regulatory interventions privacy is going to create more problems than it will solve. And third comment, citations and frame, this is about targeted advertising. Targeted advertising is an economic win-win. Everyone is better off. Consumers are better off because they get ads for items and products they are more interested in. Merchants are better off because they can allocate their advertising budget only to the right segment of consumers. And of course, the data industry is better off because they can make money by facilitating this process of matching between consumers and firms, right? So there are these three frames which are summarizing maybe a little abruptly as privacy does not make much economic sense. Loss of privacy is the price to pay for big data. Don't try to regulate it because you would kill this beautiful engine of growth. And sharing personal data is an economic win-win. To these three frames, I will propose some alternative frames, and then I'll let you decide which ones you find are more accurately depicting the kind of economy and society we live in now. So I'll start by the first one. The privacy doesn't make economic sense. Actually, this dates back to the early days of the economics of privacy. Some of you have economic ground, maybe familiar with the work of scholars like Posner, Stigler, in Chicago School of Economics, or very laissez-faire free market economics. And the point was that once you remove information from the marketplace by protecting privacy, you create inefficiencies and you create redistribution. So people pay cost if they cannot access your data, because maybe an employer may end up hiring an employee who has a drug addiction, and if this employer cannot do the adequate drug testing before hiring the employee, the employee, then the employer will pay the cost of this privacy of the employee. Well, it turns out that also the lack of privacy is redistributive, in the sense that Alverian is a very famous economist. Indeed, he was my mentor at Berkeley. Now he's the chief economist at Google, interestingly. Pointed out the following, that consumers rationally may want to share some information about themselves while protecting other information about themselves. Now, Al was writing about this in 1996 in the days of telemarketing, so that was the privacy concern of the day. But the rationale of his argument is very much applicable today. His point was that, hey, when a telemarketer calls you, you actually may want the telemarketer to know the kind of things you're interested in. Because at least if he or she calls you, he will call you with things that are of value to you. For instance, you're interested in a holiday right now, he will offer you a holiday. You're interested in a new car, he will tell you about a new car. So there is value in sharing the data. However, you don't want the telemarketer or the seller to know too much about you. Because if the seller and the telemarketer know exactly how much you want that holiday, how much you want to pay for that car, how much you desire a certain good, then they will be able to charge you a price which is very close to what economists call reservation price, the maximum you're willing to pay. And therefore, the surplus, the economic benefit of the transaction will be appropriated by the telemarketer or the seller, not by you. So the point being that there are trade-offs between data holders and data subjects, once data is protected or not. A second example of a trade-off between different data subjects, individuals, is an experiment that we ran a couple of years ago in which we wanted to see whether US employers actually have started using internet to find information about job candidates, and more interestingly, whether they end up finding information on the internet, which is personal information protected by the US legislator, such as maybe sexual orientation or religious affiliation, and whether this information ends up affecting their decision making, such as who they call for an interview. So what we did was to create CVs and resumes and send them out to real openings in the United States, about 4,000 openings, and after the resume was received by the employer could, with no push from us, decide to search online the name of the candidate on the resume. If the employer decided autonomously to search for the name of the person on the resume, the employer would be bound to find the social media profiles that we had created for these fictional candidates. And the social media profiles included LinkedIn profiles, where the professional information was exactly matching the information in the CV, as well as the Facebook profiles. In the Facebook profiles, we had added information which was absolutely not included in the CV. Information about, for instance, the religious affiliation of the candidate, whether the candidate was, in fact, Christian or Muslim. And then we tried to capture whether there was a differential propensity of employers to call back for interviews candidates who were otherwise absolutely identical from a standpoint of educational background and professional achievements. And fair enough, we found indeed that the Christian candidate was more likely to be called for an interview than a Muslim candidate, and this difference in callback rate was particularly strong in the more conservative states in the United States. So the point being here that personal information reveal online can create trade-offs between data subjects, between us. So privacy doesn't make much economic sense. Well, actually, privacy protection can be economically rational. That's my counter-frame that I offer to you. The second frame, loss of privacy is the price to pay for the benefits of big data. What does the economic literature actually say about this? Well, I will distinguish between the economic work and empirical work. Sorry, the theoretical work and empirical work. In terms of theory, Again, the Chicago School of Economics suggests that whenever you put obstacles to data sharing, you basically are going to create economic inefficiencies. And there are, I think, valid arguments that support this view. Interestingly, however, there is also extreme work dating back even to the 1970s, suggesting that left to their own devices, companies that are interested in getting consumer data will overinvest. By overinvesting, I refer to investing more than socially optimal. So they will spend an excessive amount of effort, money, and time in acquiring data, which actually may not be useful, and which actually may even create damage down the line, suggesting that in those cases, privacy regulation could actually be helpful. From the empirical angle, well, you know that often the answer that economists give to a question is, well, it depends, and certainly in this case, this it depends, because you have very excellent work by colleagues of mine, such as Catherine Tucker and Amalia Miller, colleagues not in my university, but in the field of economics of privacy, suggesting empirically that once you start regulating the flows of data, especially in the medical sector, you start reducing technological adoption, technological innovation in certain fields, for instance, genetic testing. But interestingly, and that's why I was mentioning it depends, we also have found evidence, we, at CMU, my previous student, Idris Al-Jarid, and a series of co-authors, we found evidence suggesting the opposite in the field of HIE, health information exchanges. So we found out that in states which have regulation which doesn't just create incentives for HIEs, which are these health information exchanges, these new services which attempt to coordinate the gathering and usage of medical patients' data. In states which have not just economic incentives, but also privacy protection for the data being collected, you see a higher success rate and a higher growth rate of HIEs, suggesting that once the regulation is in place, the entrepreneurs have a clear sense of what can be done and what cannot be done with consumer data, and this unlocks their potential to actually create HIEs and make them successful. So again, the frame is loss of privacy is the price to pay for the benefits of big data. The counter frame is privacy, it depends. Privacy can increase or decrease economic surplus. And linking back to something important Morgan was mentioning in his presentation, we now know from the field of cryptography and encryption that there are plenty of tools collectively referred to as privacy-enhancing technologies, PETs, which allow us, in a way, to have the cake and eat it too, in that we can collect data while simultaneously protecting data, which is, for instance, what Apple is trying to do with differential privacy. And the final frame, sharing personal data is an economic win-win. Well, I want to show you the results of an ongoing work. This is theoretical work, so right now it has the limitation of theoretical work, but we're trying to verify it empirically. And this refers to real-time bidding. I wonder how many of you have heard this expression. Even if you have not heard it, you have experienced it, because real-time bidding happens almost all the time you go online. Happens in milliseconds, and you're not even aware of that happening. So real-time bidding relates to the complex interaction between publishers, so websites, ad exchanges, the companies that exist in the advertising ecosystem Morgan was also referring to in one of his last slides, and advertisers, the company that wants to show you ads. So imagine that the publisher may be CNN.com, and the advertisers, the company that want to reach a consumer, are New Balance or Nike, and you, the consumer, are going to CNN website. Well, CNN website, through cookies, may recognize you and may pass some information about you to an ad exchange. The ad exchange may recognize you even better and combine this information with other information they have about your IP address to conclude that you are a male of 25-year-old, probably, with an interest in certain topics. And they may pass this information to the potential advertisers, asking them, do you want to show an ad to this visitor? And the advertisers will have milliseconds to decide, with computers, of course, whether to show you an ad or not, and how much to bid in an auction to show you the ad. They send the bid to the ad exchange selects the winning bid, and the ad is shown. And like I said, this happens in milliseconds. Now, most of the economic work in this area, interestingly, is focused on just two-player model, where you see what the equilibrium and the welfare allocation of these kind of mechanisms is, study consumers and advertisers or platforms, the ad exchange and advertisers. We were interested instead in playing with a more complex model with three players. So see simultaneously what happens when you consider all three players. And in particular, we were interested in who really benefits from this process. So from an economic standpoint, where does the economic surplus generated by your data go? So we studied how this surplus go as function of how much information the ad exchange is able to collect from you and then share with the advertisers. We started with a case of no information whatsoever. So the advertisers actually do not know who you are. And there is a certain allocation of surplus. Here represented by intermediary gets lots of surplus, consumers get some surplus. The advertisers don't get much surplus because actually they don't know who you are, and therefore they cannot target the ad precisely, and they cannot target their prices precisely. Then there is the case of horizontal information, which is economic lingo to refer to, do you prefer Nike or New Balance? What's your preference between different goods? And now we have a different allocation of surplus. Then there is the case of vertical information. So the ad knows what is your propensity to pay in gross terms, whether you are a high value consumer or low value consumers. Are you more willing to pay in general, less willing to pay? And there is yet a different allocation of surplus. Finally, complete information. In the case of complete information, you see yet another allocation of surplus. And interestingly, consumer surplus is completely eaten away by either the advertisers or and the ad exchange. Why? Because consumers get what economists refer to as perfectly price discriminated. So they pay the maximum they would be willing to pay for a good. The point here being that as function of how much information is being collected and used about you, the surplus allocation, who benefits from all this market in your data, will change dramatically. And that's a lesson I would like, hopefully, you to remember. So I propose these different frames. I will not actually try to force you to believe that the second column is the more correct, but I'm curious about, during your Q&A, which ones you are finding more interesting or more correct. And if you're interested in knowing more about this field, I put here the full reference to the Journal of Economic Literature we published, as well as another article, which I didn't have the time to discuss, which is about the behavioral angles on privacy. And this was published in Science. It's much shorter, 6 pages, a good, plain, short reading. Thank you very much.
HIE study, because that's...
Thank you. So we're going to have a Q&A session that starts, but I'm going to start off with the first question. So the first question I'd like to ask is about facial recognition and other biometric indicators. There's been this increase in facial recognition right now in its use in social media and other applications. So what do you think are the potential business uses for it, and what do you see as some of the opportunities and challenges, particularly as far as notifying consumers and things of that nature?
Well, I think the business case is enormous. Because we are at a world where we want to be known, most of the time we want to be recognized, we want to be known. It's the same reason that if you go back to the same hotel more than once or a store, when somebody likes the way it feels, when somebody says, oh, Mr. Jones, da da da, all of those business cues that say you're accepted, you're part of the family, you're part of this, we care about you, are important. The question is, can facial recognition help that happen, or does it create some kind of weird veneer that makes it feel artificial and not substantive? Which means it actually has to be combined not just with facial recognition, but with other data points and other elements about that person to make it more effective. So it kind of has to get creepier or scarier before it gets better at a certain level, which, you know, we've talked about how do we do it. But some very specific business cases that you can imagine. We all know the idea of you walk into a store through facial recognition, they realize that you've shopped there regularly, you get a 20% off coupon. That's got a direct, obvious economic benefit. Now, the store wants to do that because they want you to come back, and they're not going to give you one every time. There's clear-cut economics behind that kind of activity. There's facial recognition, obviously, for limiting leakage, for a fancy word for shoplifting, using facial recognition to identify people who come into the store who have a history of shoplifting. How do we discreetly have a manager be with them at the same time? How do we How do we deal with those kinds of situations? So you have a positive, enticing customers. You have a reduction of cost. How do we limit shrinkage? How do we reduce shoplifting? So those are kind of some really obvious ones that go on. But I think, and I'll hand it over to you and then we'll take it back, but then we all recognize one of the most difficult parts is, how do I tell you what I'm about to do when it comes to facial recognition? And how do I inform you about the string that you are about to pull? Because the mere recognition of your face probably means that data is now being shared with multiple third parties, analytics providers, other data gatherers. And the problem that we face in a business context is, how do we provide you a trust framework which you understand, but also explain the string that I just pulled by identifying your face? And I think that's, and you want to talk about social security number stuff, right?
I certainly could. And by the way, I agree with you that the business opportunities associated with facial recognition are huge. The privacy concerns are also quite big, because your face is a persistent identifier. It can link your identity and your behavior across different scenarios, interestingly, both online and online. Right? You can change your email easily, your phone quite easily. Your name, not so easily, but you can. Changing your face is extremely costly, really. Unless you are like some narco drug trafficker from South America, you're probably not going to change your face, which means that most of us are already who have Facebook profiles or pages on the internet, websites or organizations are already going to be linked and tracked for years to come. This data can be captured remotely. It can be used without your knowledge and consent, making it really hard to talk about informed consent when it comes to facial recognition. And the face is really the starting point for other inferences, and Morgan was referring to this, to that, more sensitive inferences that people or algorithms could make about you. In the study, I guess you were hinting at, which we did a few years ago, we showed that we could predict social security numbers from faces. Now, it sounds bizarre to say so. It's not like the physiognomy or your face hides some secret mysterious number that we are able to extract. It's rather a chain of inferences that we can make just starting from an anonymous face, because you, in our experiment, we would take pictures of people on Carnegie Mellon campus, as well as in another parallel experiment on dating sites where people typically don't like to use their real name due to social stigma still associated with being on an online dating site. However, people do use their face, because if you don't put your face on a dating site, you're not going to get any date. And from these anonymous faces, we would try using facial recognition and cloud computing, so big processing power. We would try to find matches on social media where people do use their name, such as Facebook.
Let's do a quick question. How many of you would be cool with walking into your favorite retail store if you knew that facial recognition would result in a 20% off coupon? Most hands. Right.
How many of you would like to do that if they knew that perhaps they get a 20% increase in the price you're going to pay? Because now the merchant has identified you before you enter, as you're entering the store, and knows your willingness to pay for the goods.
Exactly.
And this is exactly a point.
This is happening.
That you don't know, you cannot know, once we give away control of your personal information, we literally give away the panorama, the horizon of outcomes.
I guess I would not use the word give away, because I would say consent, and that's where you and I might differ. You don't give it away, you enter into a transaction under which you offer, hopefully informed consent, but at least some form of consent. The example he gives, though, just to say that that's not crazy, there were some catalog companies that got themselves into hot water with the Federal Trade Commission over this, where depending on your zip code, you would get a different price in a catalog based on what zip code you were in, because of what he said, which is makes complete economic sense, which is, if I know the gap between what you're willing to pay for a certain product If I know closer to that gap, then I can charge closer to that gap, and that increases profits. And that also means that if I can lower it for other people and entice them to buy, I can increase my volume. So from the business perspective, that's a win-win. And theoretically, if I was willing to pay $5 and he's only willing to pay $4, why is that wrong? Why is there any morally wrong thing? Now, that's not my opinion. I can see why we all feel that umbrage that every American feels about how did he get a better deal than I did? But that's really what it is. It's an emotional reaction. It's not a logical economic reaction. If you're willing to pay $5 and he's willing to pay $4, and I'm not talking about life-saving medicine or food, why are we upset by that? But we are.
Well, you are, because indeed you are paying the very maximum you would have been willing
That's right.
to pay, and you are not getting a deal. I mean, it is economically rational to be upset because your surplus, economic surplus, is less, is being appropriated by the other entity. So nothing bad about that from a strictly economic perspective. In fact, economists know that price discrimination, which is what we are talking right. about, is often Pareto efficient. But if you are the consumer who is being price discriminated, you don't like it because yeah. your economic surplus is being taken away. So
eBay bidding, right? Watching that price, you know you'll pay $5, and then that person bids $6, and you're like, right? You have that tension, which realistically, you probably would have paid $6. But you had a point emotionally where you were done paying, and somebody had a higher point. Well, that's very similar. So on facial recognition, the problem that you're talking about is that it can lead to that kind of arguably business-appropriate elasticity, but I think it's one that consumers find appalling.
And I would love, whenever Lauren wants, yep. to get back to your hint about informed consent, one of my favorite topics.
Yep.
We can take a question from the audience before we get into that. So does anyone have any questions?
Many times when you go into a store to make a transaction, they ask you for your phone number or your zip code. Mm-hmm. What do y'all think about that from a privacy perspective?
The purpose that they're doing that for is obviously to link data across the information. I like show of hands. It keeps the people who are falling asleep awake. How many of you use, swipe cards? How many of you use your Starbucks card or your grocery store card? Most of us do. I do. Well, that tracks more data than almost anything out there. And so your question about your phone number or your email address, it's really just another form of your grocery store swipe card. It's the way to build a data silo. It's kind of sometimes referred to as the negative. I need an attachment point at the bottom. In the application space, we used to call them UDIDs, unique identifiers. But I need something to hook. And as Alessandro said, you can change your phone number, you can change these things, but most people don't. So I can create that as the bottom hook, and then I can stack data on top.
Mm-hmm. And another interesting layer in this is that you may decide to not to provide that information. The merchant may say, okay, don't worry, we still do the transaction. Or eventually the merchant may decide, actually no, without this I cannot complete the transaction. What I'm referring to is what some people have started referring to as a privacy externality, the fact that as more and more people around you become comfortable revealing certain personal information. If you actually care about privacy, you may find it harder and harder to protect your privacy because it may become a requirement, an expected condition of service that you reveal certain data. So when the larger the group of people who reveal the information, the harder it is for those who care to actually keep protecting it.
Do we have an example, though? I mean, that's one that I've read in the literature, but I've never actually heard of a retail experience that said, we won't sell to you unless you provide this data.
So we don't,
I have never heard of one actually doing that.
We have analogies or examples online. Facebook initially allowing you to register right. without providing a phone number, and then establishing this phone number, the link between phone number and your Facebook profile, for instance.
Right, but then again, the flip side of that has been the anti-bullying campaigns that are trying to de-anonymize to prevent hate speech. Mm-hmm. So it gets into the flip side of that argument, which is we need to tear down your privacy so that really bad people doing really bad things can be at least shown to be that situation. I mean, it's the reality that we faced on Facebook, that you faced on Twitter in a huge way, where Twitter is under assault by all sorts to say no more anonymity because anonymity is creating a toxic, hateful environment. This is the balancing line we walk on. So I think your online examples are great. His example of a retail one, I've never actually heard of a retail example of a transaction being halted for information. But if one happens, that'd be an interesting
case. I actually do have an example. I used to work at Macy's a while ago, we'll put it that way. And in order to have my credit card payment and have the Macy's card, you had to give your social security number. And I had to give it not just when I filled it out or whatever, but to any time I wanted to make a payment on my Macy's card or pay with it if there were any kind of an issue. And I pushed back against it, but particularly because the person who was going through the transaction didn't know any other way.
Your point.
She just wouldn't let it continue without me providing my social security number to somebody who I had never met in a public place. And so I felt very uncomfortable, but it was either that or not have service, and so.
That's a great.
Or if you try to discuss the HIPAA form when you go to the doctor, right? If you try to say, no, actually, I don't agree with this usage of the data.
Although HIPAA is a separate hell. I spend an enormous amount of my time on HIPAA, and unfortunately, HIPAA has led to so much patient harm because physicians and hospital groups are so afraid of liability that now they treat HIPAA as a right to say no. Here's some facts. Your doctor can communicate to you over email or text with you. It is not barred by HIPAA. They need to inform you that they may have a secure methodology to do it, but the number of doctors who just simply refuse because, HIPAA.
HIPAA
doesn't do that.
It's indeed misinformation about HIPAA.
And HIPAA's one of its main purposes was to actually make your data yours and portable. But it's turned into, it's flipped on itself, where it's used as a privacy battering ram that actually harms patients. A lot of patient groups, especially those with orphan diseases, are some of the biggest advocates against the way that it is actually harmed, because physicians can't inform information, they can't provide information to communities. It's a really difficult thing. So HIPAA is one of those times where well-intentioned legislation gets either through regulation or fear, creates some problems. So HIPAA is one we have to figure out. And the other thing is, just so everyone knows, HIPAA does not cover your wearables. It has nothing to do with that. The only people who are covered by HIPAA are covered entities. So if somebody says that I've got a HIPAA-compliant blah, 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 it's not true. The only people who have to comply with HIPAA are covered entities, which are doctors, insurers, healthcare providers. One last funny thing. Your parents or grandparents might watch a show on USA Network about this guy who has a concierge practice on
Royal Pains.
Royal Pains. You will have never watched it. It's only for the olds. but interestingly enough, he's a concierge doctor. He technically doesn't have to comply with HIPAA because he does not file electronic insurance forms. He is not a covered entity. So weirdly enough, there are these bizarre loopholes that exist in this privacy law as well. So HIPAA is its own separate class of, oh my goodness.
Any other questions?
As artificial intelligence and algorithmic recommendations continue to increase and customers are interacting more with computers or machine learning, what concerns or insight do you have on how companies should handle kind of social gaffes that occur around sensitive or stigmatized, kind of complex human issues? And what responsibilities do you think the owners of those algorithms might have?
Could you provide an example of a social gaffe?
Yes. So recently, Google released software where it could identify faces, and it identified some people's faces as gorillas.
Gorillas.
Yeah. and there was a lot of backlash on that, clearly.
Thank you.
So the question is very good. I honestly do not have a good answer because I keep going back and forth on this argument myself. On the one hand, I can see how with algorithms, we could do wonderful things. We could use personal data to predict whether you will have a certain disease before you even know it, and therefore cure it early on when there is enough time to stop the progress of the disease, et cetera. On the other hand, we are getting into what has been defined as a black box society, where more and more decisions will be made, and already made as of now, without our knowledge, by algorithms, which interestingly, not even the creators know fully how they actually work. So we are all marching together happily into this big, incredible societal experiment. It really is an experiment, and all of us are participants in it. I really don't know what the eventual outcome of the experiment is. So I fail in giving you a straight answer of what should we do about that? Should we stop algorithms? No, that's unthinkable, right? How do we regulate them? It's hard. There are some researchers who attempt to discover whether algorithms bring implicitly discrimination. Okay, so not of the type you were mentioning, which was clearly a big mistake by the algorithm, but whether the algorithm, without even knowledge of its creators, end up discriminating against people of a certain race or religion and so forth. So there is some work in research trying at least to get some degree of, I wouldn't call it really transparency, because really these algorithms are so opaque, but at least some small degree of oversight. To what extent we can, outside the companies which are developing and curating these algorithms day by day, from the outside, monitoring them, that's a big question. And I don't have an answer, but it is something that concerns me.
So I think one of the key information elements here that we have to consider is data is worthless. I love it when people say, oh, well, how much is that data worth? Data is worthless. Information. Right? It is deriving information from the data. And the example that you present, and the one that we often have trouble with, is that every determinative algorithm that I try to create always has false assumptions. Mm-hmm. Or the data, what's the number one rule if you're in programming? You know, garbage in, garbage out. Mm-hmm. If I have inaccurate information. If that information presupposes certain characteristics that I don't even realize, so the data that I've pulled from, say, BLS, right, Bureau of Labor Statistics, or I pull in some data from, we've done a big project on looking at computer science education. You may not know this, but it's easier to find a class in AP Latin than AP Computer Science in the United States. It's bad. So we've done a big data project looking at over 10,000 high schools, every congressional district, the whole country. What we found is there's a lot of bad assumptions that are made and data that's essentially garbage that we're trying to have to recreate. So you had kind of a two-part question. What do we do about it? Business intelligence, BI, isn't going anywhere. It's absolutely going to be critical to every single one of you. If you are in the business world, you are going to be dealing with business intelligence. Which is just a fancy word for taking data, running it through some algorithms to give you a result based on the queries that you've created. It's not that special. We've been doing it a long time. We're just better at it now. The question you ask about handling gaffes when one of these blows up, I think that's the societal part that you know Alessandro was just reflecting. I don't know if you guys know this, but the first complainer about photography and how dare we have this huge invasion in privacy wasn't something that happened in the Facebook era. It was Louis Brandeis, who became a Supreme Court justice, who basically wrote this screed against Kodak because how dare people be allowed to take his picture while he is merely walking on the street, and this enormous invasion of privacy would lead to the downfall of American society. And Brandeis wrote this in 1890. Somebody will Google the date. How about that? Use big data to make sure I'm remembering the date right for Brandeis' treatise on Kodak. So the reality is that we have gone through these exercises, these catapults in capability that don't match where our societal expectations and norms are. The example that you give, that one in particular, I think that's one where the data scientists need to do better beta testing. they need to pull it apart first and start looking through it and saying, where are our assumptions wrong? How did we, you know, when did we just draw, oh, well, we'll pull a couple of Caucasians in and three guys who are from the Indian subcontinent, and then we're going to use those to determine orbital bridges? I'll give you an example. When the Apple Watch came out or some of these other things, they didn't have very many females on the team, and so people were asking questions about step counts. And I remember a friend of mine who was involved who said, you know, I said, well, what happens when I put it in my purse? And a bunch of the guys went, because they didn't have purses. They were, you know, they thought of it in the context of their pocket or their watch. And so the question that you ask is one where the groups that are working on it need more diversity in their group so that they have somebody there who says, what happens when I put it in my purse? Or when they go in the room and put little white dots on everybody, it's not just three sub, in, you know, Caucasian, because Indian subcontinent, and then, you know, say, well, we got diversity. That may not match, that may not do good pattern recognition. So that's a garbage in situation, and that was one that they probably need to own and say, we didn't test this enough, we didn't have enough big enough testing pool at the beginning. Own it, move on. But your larger context of the societal norming of this is going to take time.
And actually, this brings me to a question that I wanted to ask, and then we'll get to this question about oversight. Because, I mean, if there's a lot of garbage in, garbage out, and if there's some kind of a systematic issue with how people are making these algorithms, does there need to be any type of oversight for the corporate use of consumer data, or do you think that this is more of a self-regulatory environment?
I'll start with that. Absolutely, yes. From the standpoint of experiments, IRB, I am indeed in favor of comparable institutions to IRBs used by researchers in the industry. I'm in favor of ethical training for anyone who is in business analytics programs. It doesn't solve all problems, but at least some exposure to issues related to privacy and ethical usage of data is better than nothing. Mm-hmm. However, clearly, it's interesting to me that when the famous Facebook emotional contagion experiment came out a couple of years ago, all the focus was on the experiment and the researchers, a combined team of Facebook and Cornell researchers. And very little was said about the fact that Facebook actually engages in emotional manipulation every single time you connect to your Facebook profile. Facebook is constantly nudging you and influencing you and me. And I'm not saying this necessarily in a negative sense. It's just what these services do. It's nudging. They continuously do A-B testing, and they continuously adapt their interfaces to lead you to do things such as spending a little bit more time on this page or that page, clicking this link or that link. So all the attention of the researchers was kind of hiding the fact that these companies are using this vast amount of data to influence you in a way which is often unobservable and undetectable, which to me is a concern. So how do we solve that? If these companies are serious about transparency, and if they believe that more data and more openness of data is a good thing, typically they refer to consumer data, I would like to change, swap the table and apply to them. So, okay, then we want to know exactly all the data you have about consumers, when you got it, what you infer from this data, how you are using it, what implications are you drawing. That will be transparency. But currently, what we have in the United States and in the rest of the world is the complete lack of transparency. Privacy policies and notices are not transparency. They are, I wouldn't say they are a joke, because they are useful to some extent. They are necessary. Mm-hmm. You know the distinction between a necessary condition and a sufficient condition to prove a theorem?
Necessary.
They are necessary. They are totally not sufficient.
So I'm just going to ask everyone, how many people here use Facebook? How many people here have read the Facebook privacy policy? I've read it. Okay, so I'm not even going to ask the follow-up of how many people understood it. Do you feel like Facebook manipulates your emotions when you're on the site?
Well, manipulate is a loaded word. And you know that when you use it, and he knows it when he uses it. I think the problem that we're running into, I think, is that people respond to things that are that make them comfortable. And so when Facebook is engaging in that practice, if you want to call it that, they are responding to what people themselves want. And so the question is a company required to create cognitive dissonance? Is that in your bylaws? I don't think so. Mm-hmm. But that ultimately is what we're saying. And you're saying that they have some kind of societal mandate to create cognitive dissonance? It would be nice, but I know that I'm an oddball in that I really enjoy cognitive dissonance. I love being wrong. I always joke because it gives me a chance to be right again, right? You know, because I was right then, and then I found out I was wrong, and like, oh, I have something new, and I get to be right again. But I know that amongst my friends, I'm weird for enjoying that exploration. But I want to go back to this. We do have significant regulatory oversight. Your colleague is now there. Our dear friend is
Lori Craner.
Lori Craner is at the Federal Trade Commission. Through unfair and deceptive trade practices, Section 5 authority. There are regulatory oversights. I think it starts, and I agree, by the way, about IRBs in the case when you're doing those kinds of tests. I think we talked about that earlier. I think that's a good idea. I think, though, your kind of over-the-top, well, they should show us the secret sauce, is interesting from a rhetorical perspective, but completely impractical. I mean, literally in the case of Google, even though they technically use open source software, they use a caveat of GPLv2 that allows them to never expose any of the code they've ever written, and to do so would break
it may be
their entire world, so they're not gonna, so I think that's it's the
certainly,
problem.
It is certainly impractical.
And there's intellectual property.
But the intent involved here is to expose some degree of hypocrisy in the data industry that claims that complete openness with data is an economic win-win.
Oh.
If you want to believe that argument, then openness should be from both sides.
But since when is hypocrisy been rare? What is it, holding two contrary thoughts is, you know, inability to hold two contrary thoughts is a sign of a weak mind? Yes, I think there's more that we have to do on transparency. There's more that we can do to engage. But it gets back to her question about the social norming. Mm-hmm. A perfect example actually happened on something where your work was part of, and that was developing short-form privacy notices for smartphones. We spent 12 months, there were 100 of us in this room, meeting all the time. And it was a room full of privacy experts, and one of the ones that made it into the final draft was that we should show an icon or other information telling a consumer that their biometrics was being used. And my organization was assigned to do the user testing on it. And the hard problem was in that room with 100 privacy experts, everybody agreed, well, biometrics. But then we pointed out in the user testing, well, biometrics means that if you go to Zappos and they keep your shoe size, that's biometrics. But if you show a user or your mom or anyone else that Zappos collects biometrics, they're like, I'm not using that app. What does this mean? Because they didn't share the social language of the privacy experts in the same way. So belt size, shoe size, t-shirt size is absolutely biometrics. It's a measurement of your body, literally the meaning of biometrics. But here's the problem. In a privacy context, we understood, you know, your retina scan or a fingerprint, but the general consumer doesn't attach the same meaning to the words. So part of the problem he identifies is we in industry have done a poor job of communicating the string, the full length of the string of where their data go, where your person goes. Some of it's probably intentional. I think there have probably been actors out there saying, we don't want to tell people. Part of it's for business reasons, right? If you have an analytics provider on the back end, you might not want to share that agreement. They may not want anyone to know about that because for revenue reasons and for all sorts of other purposes. And some of it's just ineptitude. I'll give one last example. I do a lot of talking to developer groups, software developer groups. And I always ask this question. I say, how many of you have apps that are collecting personally identifiable information on a customer? And if it's like a room of 500 people, I'll get 150 hands. And I say, how many of you are running analytics? Everyone's hand goes up. So right there, I knew that we have a language problem. Because essentially, if you are collecting comprehensive analytics on your mobile app, you are collecting personally identifiable information on an individual. So to your question, we have a social norming problem and we have a language problem. And in order to get to your point about that we're failing on transparency, we have some of these hurdles that we have to overcome.
Next question.
So In the context of the recent Microsoft decision, is the data of US persons subject to the same protections if it's stored overseas? And are there measures we can take to make sure our data is stored there so it's better protected from the government?
So this is the Second Circuit decision. I'll talk about it if you want to, you can jump
No, please,
in,
because I'm no law scholar. I can talk maybe about the technology of protecting your data, but not about the legal issue, transnational legal issues, please.
So if you've read the case law on this and where we ended up, the hard part on this is that the Second Circuit decision essentially broke an assumption. The government made an assumption, Article 29 assumption, that basically if you are a U.S. domiciled company, that any data stored abroad was accessible through existing law enforcement measures, and that it didn't have to go through something called the MLAT process. The problem is the Second Circuit said no. Data on a foreign citizen stored abroad obviously should require a warrant issued by the governing body. Now here's the kicker. If you're a U.S. citizen and your data is stored abroad, yeah, probably the government will be able to argue that they do have jurisdiction. It gets a little dicey for dual citizens. It gets dicey in other cases. The one that I use as an example is this. Marriott is a U.S. domiciled company. Not Marriott International, but Marriott. They're a U.S. domiciled company. Do we expect, as a consumer, that if I'm staying in a hotel room in Paris, France, that because I happen to be a U.S. citizen, that U.S. law enforcement can go into my hotel room and don't have to tell French law enforcement that I'm doing that? I think the common answer is no. You can't have physical access to my hotel room without communicating with local law enforcement and going through whatever local law enforcement procedures there are. But the question you ask is, how do we protect it? Here's the context you have to start with. This is all in the context of lawful access. That means a warrant is issued. Now, a warrant is not a right to find. A warrant is a right to search. But in your example, law enforcement is going to be able to have access to your information. The question of whether or not they have to go through a process in whatever country your data is stored in, that's still up for grabs if you're a dual citizen or if you're not, it's a good question if you're a green card holder. I don't know the answer to that. That's one we should talk about. But if you are a foreign citizen in a foreign country, and your data resides overseas, then the Second Circuit has made it clear that law enforcement can't automatically access it. They have to go through the MLAT process. Does that help? Okay. And I can talk to you more about the case if you want to specifically.
And to get to the technical side, there is by now every action or transaction you do online, you can find a more privacy-preserving manner of doing that action or transaction. Because there have been 20, 30 years of research in cryptography in the industry and in academia, and they have produced things such as PGP to protect your files and emails. There are browsers which are more privacy preserving, such as Aviator, search engines which are more privacy preserving, such as DuckDuckGo. There are tools for anonymous browsing, such as Tor. There are tools for anonymous purchases, the old eCash. There is plenty of work and tools available. The caveat, however, is that some you can just use by yourself and you don't need to interact with a service to use them. Some others, they are reliant on the service allow you to use them. For instance, there have been some applications for popular social media services, which I will not mention because I don't want to sound like attacking them. But these applications allow people to use the social media services in a more privacy-preserving manner, so that the information you will share with your peers on these social networks would only be seen by your peers and who you decided, not by the service itself. So creating some form of shield. And some of these services were cut down and banned by the networks. So indicating the challenge that some privacy-enhancing technologies face, because some of them don't work in isolation. They have to be accepted not just by the users, also by the providers, which are not always willing to relinquish control over their data.
Well, but if I could bring it back home, part of the problem is that if you're in the business, then you have to be in business. And so back to Apple, Microsoft, Google, Apple can be and is incredibly privacy focused. Mm-hmm. They have made an economic decision to be pro-privacy. And they've made that economic decision because they are in the business of selling hardware, and they see that it's a benefit that their customer will likely want. So for them, it makes sense. If you're not in the business where you have some other methodology to find remuneration, that's where it really gets hard for a lot of these social networks.
I think you're hitting really on the critical issue. So once you start, although earlier in my talk, I was mentioning privacy, I was talking of privacy-enhancing technologies as having the cake and eat it too.
Right.
In reality, whenever you decrease the granularity or quality of the data, you are creating some economic cost. The interesting research question, well, not just a research question, the interesting policy and business question is, who is going to bear the cost? So imagine a society where we start having privacy by default and by design, which we can, technologically we could. In that society, there will be some cost relative to where we are now, because we will have not all the data we have now. But who is going to bear those costs? That's, to me, the critical question. Is it the apps or the data industry, the Google and the Facebook or the world, who see their profit margins going down, hopefully not to zero? Is it the consumers who are getting worse targeted offers? Or is it society as a whole? Because by removing data from the marketplace, we make it harder for the next medical researcher to discover interesting patterns in clinical data, and we decrease the probability of finding the cure for cancer in 10 years. And we really don't know what is the answer. So we don't know if we start deploying these privacy technologies by default, where the cost will be. And to me, this is one of the crucial questions that we need to address.
So I think from the perspective of this being the business school, you have to look at it from how the business intelligence that you will have access to in your future employer will help you internally, but also then how do you handle that data? Does your company, if it doesn't make money off of the data, then is this something where you want to engage in privacy differentiation? Do you want to engage in data minimization? How do you want to do it? And ultimately, I rarely find many companies that give up something for nothing. It's hard to give up data. And I'll tell you, I have never met a data scientist who's like, yes, let me give up more data. Mm-hmm. It's just not in the DNA. So the point he raises is accurate. There will be a cost, and people are addicted to free right now. It's a false free. Obviously, we all know that in our head somewhere. But boy, it tastes free when we download it, doesn't it? So I think that is ultimately the crux of the issue.
Yeah, absolutely. Are there any other questions?
Oh. Hey, so I came up with this crazy idea when Mr. Reed talked about in the 19th century, the Supreme Court judge would treat a photography like a really significant invasion of a privacy. And then I just quick think about the human history. Like, it seems like as we human being evolving, and then our privacy is actually shrinking. So with technology, your privacy is no longer protected by your fence anymore. So you're giving it out on internet, over the phone, anything. So my crazy idea is it seems like as we human being evolving, we are voluntarily giving up our privacy, and this trend is probably going on. Let's say I'm an analytical major, so let's say we do a regression and we found that out it's like a linear regression, and it's in the future, our privacy may be shrinking to maybe nothing. So what do you guys think about this idea? I just want to share it with you and discuss with you.
So I'm going to start by telling you you're wrong. It's always fun to do. And I say this in a good way. It's not what you'd expect. If you ever read Ray Kurzweil, it's very interesting stuff that he talks about human capacity to deal with exponential. We're terrible at exponential. But the reason I say you're wrong, and I'm kidding, but it has to do with time. My father grew up in a small town/village in Skagway, Alaska, where my grandfather was there. When my mom moved there, there were about 350 people in Skagway, which was very normal if you think back to society in the 1800s. Other than big cities like London and Paris and a few other places, you probably lived in a village or a town where you knew everything around everybody. That, you know, you were predestined to marry the person you were going to marry because everybody was already directing that result. So at a certain point, we went from basically no privacy. Classic example, if you look at housing in 1900s in New York, there would be nine generations or nine people in a household representing three generations. You have to ask yourself a really awkward question. How exactly did that next generation get made when there are nine different people in the house and it's a one-room apartment? So, I mean, there was distinct, incredibly personal privacy that didn't exist hundreds of years ago. Because we lived in a much more communal society where our family was in our business all the time. And we moved away from that. We gained a huge chunk of anonymity. I think your point, though, and that's why I was joking, you're not really wrong, but what we went from was complete oversight over the family and every interaction governed to an incredible sense of freedom for several hundred years, maybe. And the question now is, as we voluntarily give it up, Are we creating new families who are watching us? Are there new people who are interacting with us? But are we able to determine who that is instead of being at grandma? Maybe it's the two friends who are like, man, you've been going out drinking every night this week. Hey, why don't you come over to our house and we'll do something else? So yes, we are giving up the privacy, but I shouldn't say that we haven't had that before.
So, okay, I'll take, you're right.
Good job. So,
we have agreed on so much. I will respectfully yet strongly disagree with this. The reason being that I was hinting near the end of my slides at another piece, a review piece on privacy and behavior we published last year in Science. In writing the piece, I had the pleasure of reading outside my domain, which is behavior economics, and started reading a lot about social psychology, ethnography, psychology of privacy, history of privacy. And I discovered that the need and desire for privacy is absolutely universal across space and time. The notion that privacy is a modern invention and that back in the days we all lived in a state of constant communal sharing is just a myth. And
What I mean is that we wanted privacy, right. We didn't get it oftentimes.
Right, so there is this need which is universal.
Yep.
The ability to satisfy that need is indeed very much context dependent. It can change dramatically from society to society. But we do find evidence of privacy seeking behavior in ancient Greece, in ancient Rome. We find references to privacy in the Quran, in the Torah. You can interpret the Judeo-Christian story of Adam and Eve as the first privacy story of the world. Adam and Eve are naked in the Garden of Eden and totally comfortable with their nakedness, and they're happy. Once they eat from the fruit of knowledge, among the other things, they suddenly realize that they are naked, and they start feeling embarrassed, and they decide to cover their, how is it called in the English language? They are privates with the figs, leaves of fig. So we have really, in the Genesis, in the book of Genesis, we had the first privacy story.
You win.
So, okay, I stop there.
Does the fact that it's over a larger audience, though, matter? The fact that it's not just your two friends who are making this decision, but it's over millions of people, and that it's persistent over time as well?
Maybe I start from this and then I pass it to Morgan. Yes, because related to this very argument, you can make almost an evolutionary conjecture of humans' need for privacy. There is potentially some evolutionary advantage. However, and I could expand on this because we actually have a study ongoing about that. But the issue is, if we have evolved to be able to manage our privacy, meaning the balance between public and private, in an offline world, in a non-digital world, it is clear that now that we have been about 20 years with the internet and maybe, I don't know, 70 years, maybe one century with computers, we are facing an evolutionary challenge in that I'm really adept, and you guys are really adept at sharing and not sharing, deciding how to balance when you are in the offline world. You have evolved for that. When you go online, you may be sending an email to a friend, but somehow your brain is not alerting you to the fact that this email could, with one click, be posted and shared with 1 million other people. You may use WhatsApp, feeling that, okay, it's the same protection as just showing you something and then moving and then removing it from your view. But in fact, even WhatsApp or Snapchat, again, they can create scenarios where the information you relinquish goes away. The information you provide is relinquished away from your, completely from your control. And this is what we are not almost evolutionarily adept at.
Mm-hmm. Well, except, so you know Dana Boyd, you've read her stuff. For those of you who haven't, you should look at some of Dana Boyd's studies on the behavior of at-risk children in social networks. The example that Dana, and it's lowercase when you Google it up, it because it'll trigger that way, with an H at the end of Dana. She looked at the privacy-seeking behavior of, especially of kids at various stages of risk. What was fascinating, the story she often uses, is with one girl who had a social worker who was required to watch her. To keep her private information away from the social worker, every morning before when she woke up, she would delete her Facebook account. Then 8 o'clock at night, she would reform her Facebook account. Sometime 7, 6, 7, 8 o'clock at night. Any guess as to why she did that? Because the social worker was at work from 8 to 5. So every day she knew that the social worker would not be able to find any of her online activity between the hours of 8 and 5. And she also knew the social worker wasn't going to check on her between the hours of say 7 p.m. and 8 a.m. the next morning. So she went out on a privacy-seeking behavior to use the social networks to share the information with people that she was. So back to your question, she created her own, she had her own community and people she wanted to share information with. I guess I would say I have higher regards for human and their ability to come up with clever ways. Kids invent slang that their parents don't understand. Kids invent all sorts of ways to share and pass information. And I think what we're at right now is an interesting point where how we do it is still yet to be determined. I'm actually a little more concerned, frankly, and I know bullying is, you know, way too much in the news lately, but I'm more concerned that sometimes the anonymity creates these very weird, almost psychological breaks. You hear about these people who get online and troll folks, and when you meet them in person, they say bizarre things like, well, I know it's not, I don't really think of that person, and I just want to vent, and so I don't mind it. I mean, they say unbelievably evil stuff, and yet when you meet them in the street or have a coffee with them or get beer with them, they seem completely normal. And so the question I have is that how do we deal with that aspect of anonymity and privacy? Because allowing people to do really horrible stuff not also appropriate.
Very important issues, and two comments: one on anonymity, and one on the on the ability of individuals, especially younger individuals, to adapt and take control of the technology. Dana Boyd was using the term social steganography.
Yep.
If any of you is in cryptography, you know that steganography is about sending a secret message into a public channel or a visible channel. Social steganography is about using Facebook in a manner that your parents don't really understand what you're saying, but your peers know exactly what you're talking about. However, the challenge to me is this. So I agree with you partly, but the challenge is that if we have to rely on people being good about using the technology to protect their privacy, it's almost a losing fight, because there is always something else that the service providers can do to find more information about you. Let me give you an example. Initially, cookies were the privacy concern of the late 1990s. People started becoming aware of cookies. Well, the industry started creating zombie cookies or flash cookies. Similar thing on social network. People started using tools to protect their traces or be more private. Well, the service providers find other ways to track you. So you may be able to protect yourself from the social worker or from your parents. You are not able to protect yourself from the service provider, from the Facebook, from the advertising companies, and so forth. Now, on the issue of anonymity, it's interesting because the psychological and social psychology literature on anonymity suggests that anonymity can create both pro-social as well as definitely anti-social behavior. So to me, the issue is less anonymity per se and whether we can create a ecosystem which promotes good behavior and punishes bad behavior. And there have been some online systems which, even though they rely on, I wouldn't call it anonymity, pseudonymity, because there is clearly a difference between anonymity and pseudonymity. With pseudonymity and persistent pseudonyms, you can actually enforce good social norm which avoid the kind of trolling behavior you're referring to.
I guess my only thing would be I don't like your word choice of protect yourself from the provider. I don't think of Facebook as trying to cause you harm. You protect yourself from someone who's trying to cause you harm. I get your point. I think, though, especially since we're at the business school, I think what you're hearing is, though, that language is something you're going to have to face. When you build a tool at your next company or they want to do something, you need to explain it to the user in a way that they don't feel like they need to protect themselves, to use Alessandro's word. You have to find a way to make it something that they want to adopt, that they want to bring into their lives, and that they're willing to have, whether you agree with the left column or the right column, the narrative of the privacy and economics. They need to be willing to accept whichever column it is and participate in your activity. So I take a little bit of exception to the word protect, but I think it reflects not an abnormal way to look at the world. I'm hoping that we in the business community can do a better job to
and making consumers don't feel like they need
exactly.
I hate to jump in, but we actually only have time for one more question now, so I want to make sure I get it. So
our answers might not be.
I'll speak loudly. Going back to the example that you said, both of you guys said about paying different prices for the same product. Do you think that happens today to a certain extent? For example, like a rain jacket with like same fabric, same zipper. One could be sold at like Kirkland for one price, and North Face for a completely different price. And people consensually and even happily buy the North Face one because it's North Face. So is that really that much different than sending like the targeted catalogs?
It's super normal. We know that everything's built in the same factory. I spent 3 years in China working in that kind of world. So yes. What happens is true, but there's also other elements of it. Remember, the brand that's on it has some social connotations to it that are seen as economically advantageous. So, it's why the kids don't want to wear clothes from Sears because it has a lower social stigma, even if it's made in the same factory. So it's a little hard to use that example because we're making an economic choice based on what we see as the perceived outcome or benefit from making that choice. People will think I'm rich or like me more or think I'm more attractive by the label on it.
And the to give you a very short answer to your question, is anything different from price discrimination already exists? Is anything different online? I can give you a short answer. The problem is that it's technical. Economists talk about 3 degrees of price discrimination, first, second, and third. The third relates to group and categories. The second is self-driven. I buy a business class fare on a plane rather than coach. The first one is the theoretical one, where you can pinpoint exactly the reservation price, meaning the maximum willingness to pay of each single consumer for each possible good. And that used to be considered completely theoretical, textbook idea. But in fact, second and third were what happens in practice, including your example of the fleece jacket. What is happening on the internet right now is that we are getting closer and closer to making first-degree price discrimination possible. We are still not really doing it because it's still pretty difficult to, on a per-person basis, really identify the willingness to pay for each good. But we are getting closer and closer to the kind of world. And it's quite interesting.
Maybe the analytics company you start will do it.
All right, well, thank you very much, both of our panelists.